Priyambada ma'am and Pradhan sir, please come forward for the lighting of the lamp.
Sarkar and friends, we are very happy that Prof. Sarkar has joined as the visiting professor for this month. So he will be speaking on spirituality and religion, the distinction between the two, with regard to Rabindranath Tagore and a great Western philosopher, Wittgenstein. So he will be going into the details of this problem, whether spirituality is primary or religion is primary, and whether there can be a religion without spirituality and vice versa. So anyway, before I invite her to speak, let me introduce her. Professor Priyambada Sarkar is professor at the Department of Philosophy, University of Calcutta. She completed her PhD from King's College, London, 1982 to 86. She has co-edited 6 books and authored 3 books, namely Wittgenstein and Solipsism, Uttar Parvel Wittgenstein, Philosophical Investigations in Bengali, Tatparya Obi Bhachya, Tregir Bhasa Darshanir Bhumika in Bengali. And she has also, she was awarded the Fellowship of Indian Institute of Advanced Study, IIAS, between 12 and 14, and the manuscript is forthcoming from Oxford University Press in collaboration with IIAS. She was also a visiting senior fellow at King's College, London, between 2001 and 2002. Prof. Sarkar is president of Ludwig Wittgenstein Philosophical Society, India, and a life member of British Wittgenstein Society, UK. She has been invited to deliver lectures in University of Cambridge, University of Vienna, and Pontifical University of Rome, Jahangir Nagar University, Bangladesh. Prof. Sarkar has also organized multiple lectures, seminars, and conferences. As the coordinator of the Special Departmental Research Support Program, SHAP DRS, developed by University Funds Commission at the University of Calcutta. With these few words, now I request Prof. Priyambada Sarkar to deliver a lecture.
First of all, I'd like to thank the Institute, the Director, the Secretary, at the Institute staff, and all other persons who have invited me and given me this opportunity to share my thoughts with the learned audience. I personally thank profusely to my chairperson, Professor Pradhan sir, who has kindly agreed to chair the session. Now, as you all must be knowing, that I'll be giving 3 lectures in a month. So, just for the beginning, I'll give you an overview so that you can have an idea of what I'm going to do. And then I'll separate them into 3 lectures. Now, first about the distinction between religion and spirituality. In fact, all of you must have known earlier that usually these two terms were used as interchangeable terms. And to think of etymology, the term religion, we derive it from the root religio, which means a bond which exists between man and superhuman power and a respect for the sacred. And to talk about spirituality, it comes from the root spiritus, which means something concerning breath or life. There is one term, spiritualis, which means man of spirit, breath, life or spirit. And in early 15th century, the term spirituality used to be associated referred in things pertaining to church in the context of religion. So you see, etymology shows that these two terms are related from the beginning. But recently, not very recently, but still, with the advent of secularism in the West, these two things are being separated. Champions of the of secularism, they developed an objective moral and social account of the universe, and they had expected that with the gradual advancement of science and technology, religion will have a slow and steady death. But somehow it didn't occur. And in 80s, sociologists of religion, they critiqued these champions of secularism, and they said that with the era of globalization, in a globalized world, we have to look at religion from a new angle. We need transformation of religion. And such transformation can occur only when one can deinstitutionalize religion. So there comes the notion of deinstitutionalization of religion and a debated concept of privatization of religion. Now, I'm not going into the debates and controversies regarding privatization of religion, but what I want to focus is that why do people want to come away from the original ideas of religion? And what are the things that they try to associate with spirituality? It seems that spirituality is somehow associated with, first, against, it is antipathetic, it's not at all sympathetic, it's a critic of institutionalization of religion. And second, they talked about personal spirituality, like personal closeness to God, and a kind of interrelatedness with the whole universe. So these three ideas are the core ideas of spirituality. Now, what I'll do in these lectures is to show that two great thinkers, one a poet, a mystical poet from the East, and another legendary, influential, analytic philosopher of the West, Tagore and Wittgenstein. I'm sure that you all will be wondering, why this and? Why am I using the word and, Tagore and Wittgenstein? Does it sound like chalk and cheese? Like these two things, they cannot be come under one head. In my second lecture, I'll elaborate the meaning of the word and when I combined Tagore and Wittgenstein. Here today, I'll focus on the transition from the domain of the religious to the domain of the spiritual in the life and works of Rabindranath Tagore. Now, before I enter into the main components of my deliberation, I'd like to say that usually it's common among Indian intelligentsia and erudite scholars to think that Tagore was a Brahmo, and that's the end. What about his religion? As far as religion is concerned, he was a Brahmo. And you know what Brahmo Dharma is? It's a monotheistic religion based on the philosophy of Upanishads. And second, his philosophy is the philosophy of Upanishads. These two are common ideas among intelligent, erudite people of India. Now, in this lecture, I'd like to explore these two myths. Like, he was not a Brahma. Not only that, he didn't believe in any kind of religion as such. And the second one, his philosophy is not the philosophy of Upanishads. Now, when I'm saying not, it's not like P and not P. Like, not P cancels everything what is there in P. No, it's not like that. That means there was something. Like, it's not the whole truth. It's partial truth, half truth. And you know, half truth is more dangerous. So with these two cautionary notes, I'll begin my deliberation. Now, just for the background, now, as far as spirituality is concerned, in Tagore's case, I pointed out five components of spirituality. First one is aversion to institutionalized religion. Second, his religion was the religion of an artist. And third, feelings of interconnectedness with the universe. Fourth, closeness to God and Lord of life, Jivan Devota. And finally, experiencing the mystical. Now, for the background, I must say that you all know that he was born in a Brahmo family, and his father, Devendranath Tagore, in fact, he hated the Adi Brahmo Samaj of Kolkata. Then, when Tagore was 23, in 1884, he was given the job of a secretary of Adi Brahmo Samaj. And with full vigor of a 23-year-old youth, he disbursed his duties in the sense that he argued. On the one hand, he argued against the new Hindu revivalists like Bankim Chandra Chattopadhyay and others. And on the other hand, Brahmo Samaj was also divided into old and new, and also the advocates of new Brahmo Samaj. He used to argue. At that period of life, he was totally under the influence of his father's Ramadharma, and that period when he was writing Nolpetto, some of which are condensed in the poems of Itanjali also, he was under the spell of Ramadharma and his concept of personalized God. Like during 1900 and 1901, we find clear articulation of his thoughts about Dharma in Noibeddo, where he hasn't departed from Upanishadic ideals, and Maharshi's influence, Maharshi means his father's influence, as far as devotion to personalized God is concerned. As an example, we can refer to a poem of Noibeddo, number 90, when in the morning, when in the morning I looked upon the light, I felt in a moment that I was no stranger in this world, that the inscrutable without name and form had taken me in its arms in the form of my own mother. This idea of personalized God, that God as his own mother, came to him through reading the Upanishads and Devendranath's book, Ramadharma. Most of the poems written in 1896 to 1906 reveal the religious ideology of Adi Brahma Samaj. With the passage of time, he got disillusioned with the religion. Not only with this religion, he was disillusioned with other institutionalized religions also. And then I'll come to abortion. I think something has gone wrong. Now this is abortion to institutionalized religion. First of all, he revolted against Brahmadharma, as because he was born in a Brahma family, and when he was initiated into Brahmadharma, he reacted against this Brahmadharma. He had an aversion to definite creed and to religions based on scriptural authority. He argued, man is defeated when the authority inside him is curbed. Curbed by whom? Curbed by the existence of religion, by tradition and custom, by scripture and ritual. Later in life, he recounts, I got initiation into the religion of the family, that is Brahmadharma, family I was born. That is also a pure religion, but my mind did not agree to curtail myself in accordance with that. Like every institutionalized religion has some restrictions, has some rituals you have to perform, has to curtail yourself in accordance with the dictates of the religion. He said that he cannot really guard himself. When asked about institutional religion later in life, he clearly stated that as an abstract idea, he had nothing to say against it. He had nothing to say against religion. But concretely speaking, institutional religion is bound to give rise to sectarianism. As an example, he takes care of Christianity. And he says that it is extremely difficult to become truly Christian. Yet, by following the easy path of belonging to a Christian sect, one seems to acquire the merit of being a Christian and to have a right to despise even one's betters who by chance or choice do not profess Christianity. This has invariably been the case in the religions which crystallize themselves into sectarianism. Religious communities are more often formed upon custom and held habit than upon truth. So this is the reason why he wanted to depart from institutionalized religion. In the religion of man, also he said, it was through an idiosyncrasy of my temperament that I refused to accept any religious teaching, merely because people in my surroundings believed it to be true. I could not persuade myself to imagine that I had a religion because whom I might trust believed in its value. So he was completely disenchanted with the Brahmodharma. And after that, somehow, for some time, he was captivated by the ideals of Sanatan Hindu Dharma. Because he had the impression that Hindu Dharma is not institutionalized. So when in Shantiniketan he founded the school of Brahmavidyalaya, at that time there all the rules and regulations were initially in accordance with the dictates of the Dharma Shastras. Like in earlier times, among the teachers there were Brahmin teachers and non-Brahmin teachers, and students used to touch the feet of Brahmin teachers, but not the non-Brahmin teachers. They used to do them they used to do the namaskaram, like with folded hands. So it was critiqued. Bengal never had dearth of critics. So the critic then asked, why is this? Why is this distinction in your institution? Then he once described it to the principal of the school, that in my institution, in my school, there will be nothing which goes against the dictates of Sanghita, of Hindu Sanghita. Says, what is contrary to institutional Hindu practices will not have any place in my school. The practice is obviously in accordance with Sanghitas. So, for a brief period of time, he used to believe in the Hindu Dharma. But this phase also didn't last long. Communal riots and distribution of seats of Hindus and Muslims in parliament made him realize that he was mistaken in thinking that Hindu Dharma is not institutionalized. We notice his concern for using religion as an instrument for violence also. We pride ourselves on having made religion the basic principle of our life, and so we see that brutality in the name of religion is widespread in this country. It is so true even in these days. In the name of God, Hindus and Muslims are killing each other like ferocious beasts. Straightforward rejection of all distortions of religion is far better than this kind of blind and horrifying attachment to religion. Apart from burning down all religious perversions in the fire of atheism and making a fresh start, I do not see any other solution. So that was the time when his love for Hindu Dharma is over. Then for some time, he was infatuated by the Vaishnava Dharma also. Apart from Orthodox Hinduism, Tagore was also influenced by Vaishnavism in his early years. He came to contact with the music and lyrics of Vaishnavism, which made a deep impression on his mind. From the Vaishnavites, in saying that we can enjoy the beauty and harmony of our mundane world, once he had an interview with E.J. Thompson, and Thompson asked directly that, are you influenced by Vaishnava poets and Vaishnava dharma? Then Tagore said that, I found in the Vaishnava poets lyrical movement and images startling and new. They gave me form. They make many experiments in meter, and there was the boldness of their imagery. Now, this is true, but we cannot really say that he accepted everything from Vaishnavism, because he liked Vaishnavas. Whatever he liked is that the infinite longs for the union with the finite. This is something which appeals to him, and it was present in various songs and poems of this period. The finite feels the pang of separation from the infinite, and the infinite requires the finite, for the fulfillment of life, love, is a purely Vaishnava idea. This view seems to be justified when one refers to the following poem in Gitanjali. Is it thy delight to see thy creation through my eyes, and to stand at the portals of my ears silently to listen to thy own eternal harmony? Thou givest thyself to me in love, and then feelest thine own entire sweetness in me, like approaching God as a lover. And he adopted the Vaishnava concept of Milan, Obhishar, Viraho. But he molded them with his own ideas. God fulfills himself and expresses his best through man. God needs man as much as man needs God. The human being is the center of God's activity. He clarifies, I felt that I had found my religion at last, the religion of man, in which the infinite became defined in humanity and came close to me so as to need my love and cooperation. So, what is the distinction between a Vaishnavite and Tagore? A Vaishnava is eager to divinize man, whereas Tagore's mission is twofold: the divinizing of man and humanizing of God. So we cannot really equate Vaishnavism with purely with the account of Tagore. Moreover, he differs from the Vaishnavites in saying that we can only enjoy the beauty and harmony of our mundane world. He didn't want emancipation. He didn't want liberation from this world of senses. And he said that you can have emancipation, you can have liberation in this world, not in Vaikuntha, as the Vaishnavites think. He also distances himself from Vaishnava preoccupation with ritualized service of the deity, and frees himself from the teachings of some organized body of worshippers, like a group of people who goes on doing the Nam Sankirtan, etc. So we see that as he had an aversion to institutionalization. We noticed that he had aversion to Brahma Dharma first, then Hindu Dharma, then Vaishnavism. Now we'll come to the second important parameter of spirituality, religion of an artist. He gradually developed a kind of his own inner religion. He elucidates, everyone has something special called my religion. But the trouble is, he doesn't know exactly what it means. He knows that I'm Christian, I'm Muslim, I'm Vaishnava, I'm Shakta. But even if he is certain that he belongs to an established religion throughout his life, he may be mistaken. Which is his religion? Is it the religion that lies hidden in his heart and keeps on creating him secretly from inside? An inherent religion, an instinct of life, builds up all that is animal and living. The animal need not have any sense of that religion. Man has another being greater than his physical being, that is his humanity. The creativity that is inside this being is his religion. It can be termed aesthetic religion or the religion of a poet or an artist. So, you know, in that way he's saying that man is equal to God. In which way? Because God creates. God has this capability. And man has also this capability. And in this way, this creativity, because of this creativity, man is distinguished from animal. And this is, in Tagorean terminology, this is called surplus. How are human beings different from animals? Animals also have some tendencies, like they also care for the young. They also have feelings for their young generation. They also love their other members of the species. But what happens? They cannot go beyond that. He has a poem. He says that Pakhire diyecho gaan gaay shei gaan. Like birds can sing. What can they sing? Whatever God has given them. But man is different. Man creates music. Ami tar beshi kori daan, ami gaay gaan. I can sing, I can dance, I can create singing, I can create tunes, I can create everything. So I'm different from animals. This is the surplus. This is the surplus of man, which is rooted in man's creativity. While by using this creativity, you can lift yourself from the mundane world and can be equal with someone, if there is anyone called God. Now, this quotation suggests that Tagore was clearly distancing himself from established religions and searching for a religion that lies hidden in his heart and creates him anew in every moment. Now, he believed that God is the supreme person. He attributed personality to God. Tagore says, it's not in my own individual personality that reality is contained, but in an infinite personality. This is a peculiar conception of God. As God is not an abstract reality like Vedanta's Brahman, nor he is a Saguna Brahman like Ishvara, he is personal, but that does not indicate him that he is a finite God whom we worship. We feel him in each and all that is not only in nature, but also in the family, in society, in the state. God is the concrete spirit. God is the concrete spirit. Now Tagore realizes that this God is within us, but we wrongly search him in the outer world. He is to be sought in one's inner world, in oneself. This search is for someone who's the man of his heart. This conception of man of one's heart, Moner Manush, developed gradually in religion of man. Not only that, this man makes one feel specially connected with nature, with other human beings, and finally with the universe. So this is the second parameter of spirituality. Now the third one is feelings of interconnectedness with the universe. When a man does not realize his kinship with the world, he lives in a prison house whose walls are alien to him. His love for the world and his intimacies with nature provide the background for his view of man's relation with nature, along with man's relation with other human beings and ultimately with the universal man with capital U. He says, "I have never looked at God, man and nature as problems which can be considered in isolation from each other. I could never conceive of their occupying watertight compartments. They are not separated from each other." His philosophy presents the integral picture of God, man and nature. Now, nature as an integral whole is the source of man's inspiration for creation, his songs, paintings, dances. While he creates, he becomes aware of the surplus, of excess emotional energy which does not get satisfied with simple preservation, whereas animals' energy that gets satisfied with preservation of the species. That is why man seeks outlet in the creation of art, literature, music and dance. While creating, man becomes aware also of his power to go beyond the factual or scientific world, to go beyond his physical finitude. Whenever I feel the unity of the creative power within myself, I also feel connected to the infinite creativity of the universe. Like the sun, the moon, the stars, I become aware of an abiding creative power within me, which is in control of my desires and disappointments. Then, the fourth one, closeness to God and Lord of life. Now, who is this Lord of life? Our traditional God of religion. Can we label his account of personality as religious? He himself was not very sure of it. His confusion can be sensed in the following quotation. "I cannot claim that I am able to understand and absorb religion in its general sense, but I can say with certainty that there is something that is living in me. It is a feeling of mystery, not a dogma. It is a distinct awareness in the mind. I can sense that my life's joys and sorrows and my faith will together give my life a certain harmony. I don't know whether the scriptures are true or false. What I do know is that they mean nothing to me. So the sacred scriptures of institutionalized religions," he says, "that they mean nothing to me." In his mature life, once he had been interviewed regarding his own view of God and religion, and surprisingly, he brings out similarities of his own religion with that of New Testament. In the sense that God, according to Christ, was related to us in a spiritual relationship of love. He finds in the New Testament concept of God reflections of his own idea of closeness to personal God as father, friend, and lover. When he had been asked, "How do you know that there is a God?" his reply was, "My personality constantly seeks union with other personalities. And on the day when I realize the perfection of unity with them, it is glad and is filled with delight. If this craving of my personality for supreme satisfaction exists, my poetic imagination must invent And my reason demand a foundation of unity somewhere where my whole being can obtain permanent shelter, where I can feel happy, find contentment and be at peace. In this realm of thought, argument is no longer of much use. Men on this earth have from time to time procured or experienced direct evidence of God in and through our own personality. So for him, the personal God of religion is the supreme personality as experienced in religious exaltation. This feeling tells us that our personal I must have perfect relationship with the infinite personality. Tagore talks about such mystical experiences of religious ecstasies in Religion of Man. Tagore was not a believer in scriptures, nor was he in favor of rational argumentation to prove the existence of God. For him, it is a matter of experience, a matter of feelings. And he talked about such mystical religious experiences in Hibbert lecture. He says when he was 18 and he was standing in the balcony of their Sadi Street residence, then suddenly something happened. I'm quoting, "I suddenly felt as if some ancient mist had in a moment lifted from my sight, and the morning light on the face of the world revealed an inner radiance of joy. The invisible screen of the commonplace was removed from all things and all men, and their ultimate significance was intensified in my mind. Like this special mystical experience convinced that there is no distinction between self and He becomes the curtain which was drawn between himself and the rest of the world that had been lifted when he had that special experience. Now, this spiritual ecstasy, now what happened when he had that experience next morning, this feeling continued for some time. Then he wrote a poem which depicts the ecstasies, religious ecstasies in poetic form. This is an extraordinarily beautiful poem. The spiritual ecstasy resulted from his perfect relationship with the infinite personality which lied within himself. It lifted the veil of difference between the self and other. This other doesn't mean the other human beings. It means the difference between the river, the mountains, the non-living and non-living universe. There is no distinction. This blissful experience goes beyond the factual and it helps one to stand on an equal footing with other religious beliefs, practices and experiences. Then he draws a distinction between religion and theology. He says that a man where he is religious is a person, but not where he is a mere theologian. His feelings for the divine is creative, but his mere knowledge of the divine cannot be formed into his own essence because of this lack of emotional fire. He despises a theologian. Why? Because a theologian provides arguments for the existence of God. A theologian provides rituals for a particular religion. A theologian provides restrictions how a person should lead his life. But not a religion. Religion here, he's using the word religion, but the meaning of it extends far beyond. Tagore, a poetic genius, understandably emphasizes the role of emotion in transmuting inanimate things into stream of consciousness, and also the role of creativity in identifying a religious man as a person. Now, here you might get confused that he is using the word religious man, but in the sense that it is referring to a spiritual person. It also explains why at the fag end of this, like when he was looking for his own inner religion, not in the outside universe, but in his own heart, at that time he was fascinated by the philosophy of bowels. Now he said that what struck me in the simple song, their bowel song, was a religious expression that was neither gross concrete, full of crude details, nor metaphysical in its rarefied transcendentalism. The bowel songs are simple. They do not propagate any high sounding metaphysical theories, and that is also not grossly concrete. At the same time, it was alive with an emotional sincerity. It spoke of an intense yearning of the heart for the divine who is in man, man with capital M, and not in the temple or scriptures, in images and symbols. The worshipper addresses his songs to man, the ideal. He expresses it in a song beautifully. The temples and mosques obstruct thy path, and I fail to hear thy call or to move. So all these rituals, all these texts, all these buildings which are sacred, what do they do? They obstruct your path. Your means the supreme personality, the infinite personality. Now then, finally, he says, I do not know if I can be called religious in the current sense of the term. He himself is doubtful whether he can be called a religious, not claiming as my possession any particular idea of God authorized by some time-honored institutions. And this is with this quotation, I would like to end this journey from the religious to the spiritual of this journey of Rabindranath Tagore. And at the same time, I want to remind you almost the same type of utterance we get in Ludwig Wittgenstein. He says, he once told to his friend and student, Michael Drury, that I'm not a religious man, but I cannot help seeing every problem from a religious point of view. One might find it contradictory, but this is not a contradiction, and we will be discussing this. It's a very controversial passage, and lots of books have been written for the interpretation of this remark, and we'll go into that in our next lecture. Thank you.
Friends, we have listened to a very illuminating lecture on the philosophy of Rabindranath Tagore. The concepts which Rabindranath Tagore has experimented with are the concepts like Jivan Devata, the religion of an artist, the religion of man, and also the concept of personalizing God or humanizing God. These are some of the very innovative concepts and which need really a fresh understanding on our part. Sarkar has given sufficient food for thought for all of us. Now I would like to invite questions and queries regarding these concepts, these thoughts, from all of you. So please. Yes.
Thank you, ma'am, for enlightening us. It was really wonderful, and for me it was first time I could listen to such a in-depth discourse on Rabindranath Tagore's other part of the two confusions. I think wasn't he himself confused with the locating religion with man, institution, nature? So it really confuses one what he exactly wanted to say. On the one hand, he is trying to take us closer to nature and denying institutionalization of religion, which is more in Western sense, or he was drifting away from Indian sense of Dhamma or Dharma also. That is one confusion I have. Secondly, does his idea of universalism, universality and naturality addresses any material realities when he's talking about universality of humanity, human beings? How will it address our day-to-day materialistic issues, like if I may connect it to largely political issues, border states, where human beings will be utterly selfish and self-centered, countries will be self-centered only. So how does Tagorean idea matters in present world? Can it help? Thank you.
After this.
Shall I reply?
Yes, yeah.
Okay. Then one thing, because it's a, you know, it's a kind of vast ocean, and within 1 hour, I could give you a very small amount of information to you. Like the question you said, how is it relevant in today's world? Now he has distinguished between two kinds of selves within us. One is, in Bengali it's called choton, small, and another is boron. That is, who is this small I? The person with such and such physical bodily structure, with such and such mental makeup, with such and such attitude with the world. This is your choton. But this chotoni, when this ami is thinking of the world in his own aspirations, ideals, and achievements, and finding others as competitors, finding others as enemies, they are other, who is giving, who is curtailing, banishing the other from his own self. But he, within himself, has this boron, the bigger self, that connects with everyone. Then why can't we realize it all the time? Why are we becoming so petty, so mean all the time? Because we forget that we have this bigger, all-comprehensive self within me. And how can, when do we feel that there is such a self that is also me? When we create, in my creativity, I realize I can have a glimpse of that higher self within myself. So it's the creative, that's why one of the point was religion of an artist. So this is relevant, very much relevant, because it's now the time to realize that I also have this higher self within myself, with the help of which I can transcend the narrowness, with the help of which I can become equal with the Creator, with the God. This is one. And the second one, that is, I'll refer to his writings, because, you know, in politics, in a state, in a society, he wants to say that there should be a spirit. Like if even in institution, there should be a spirit. And if the spirit is lost, and you do everything all right mechanically, the institution will not survive. So it's the spirit. Everything has a spirit. And he has talked a lot about our nation, our nationalism, and all this, and our political things. I'll ask you to read more Tagore. He's very relevant in today's world.
Okay, next friend.
Yes.
Please come forward.
Yeah, it was a beautiful discourse on spirituality and religion, man. I did like your arguments in it, but there was a statement relating to New Testament, I think, wherein he is saying, I believe in New Testament, new idea of religion. This is what really confused me, because when you talk about like Bible is based on logocentrism, logo word, you can say. Right, and if you read the book of Genesis, the beginning was word was with God. The whole context of logocentrism. And I do believe that this logocentrism is a system of thought, you can say, or a form of reasoning or thought, which really excludes the other. Any religion has this weakness of excluding the other. If suppose I believe in Buddhism, so Buddha is at the center, whereas the others are at the margins. So I'm really confused whether he is going for this, any kind of religion as such, or you talked about history. So in that context, you can say, I would like to know. And And secondly, I was wondering whether you can say, when he's talking about divinizing the human and humanizing the God, what is it he is referring to? Referring to a new world of existence, new world of thought, new world of religion, which he is aspiring to? So these are the questions.
Now, the first thing that you told, that Bible is logocentric. Logos means science. Logos means reason. So, if you want to mean Bible is reason-centric, I have a hunch, probably you wanted to mean Bible is anthropocentric. Bible is definitely had this anthropocentric lineage, which because it's there in the Bible that I have created this world for you, the representer. I cannot exactly quote, but it's something like that. That this world has been created for you, it's for your enjoyment, and you should rule over the fowl of the earth, over the of the sea, of the of animal, plant, and inanimate nature. Man should rule over them. Why? Because man is created in the likenesses of the God. As because you are my replica, so I have created this world for your enjoyment. So this is mainly anthropocentric. So if this, I have no quarrel with you that this is anthropocentric. Now when Tagore said, he didn't say that he believes in Bible. He said that these sacred texts have no meaning for me. And he didn't say that he believes in New Testament. What did he say? The idea of personalized God. He takes a concept from the New Testament which he thinks comes close to his own view of a personalized God. Like God is someone, he's my father, he's my beloved. Without there's a song in Bengali which said that if I'm not around, then there'll be no one who will be your lover. God is my lover and God loves me. And in love there'll be union with me and God. So this is your first question. And the second one was?
Dehumanizing.
Huh?
Divinizing.
Oh, when I was discussing Vaishnavism, what do the Vaishnavizing, what do they do? They do divinize human beings. They have this Milan, Abhishad, all these are, what I should say, these are the concepts like Radha Krishna. You know the episodes of Radha Krishna, that there is this separation, pangs of anxiety, and this pangs of separation, and this urge to meet Krishna. This is something, this is Milan, and when he is separated, then this is Viraho, and Avishad is when he, when everyone is sleeping, she's going to meet him. This is, these concepts are there. So these are, look, these are all humanizing my, like, these concepts are anthropocentric. So what the Vaishnavas are doing, they are humanizing, they are divinizing human beings. And the Tagore's mission is twofold. It, for the Vaishnavites, I love for you. Without you, my love will not have any substance. For Tagore, yes, I love you, but you also love me. You also crave for me. You also aspire for my presence. Without me, your love will not. Amainoile tribhu bane short, tomar prem hoto je niche. You will not have your love if I am not around. So both way, transition.
Okay. Okay. I see here, welcome.
Ma'am, in your presentation you referred to the shifting views of Rabindranath Tagore from being a Brahmo to moving towards Vaishnava Dharma, acceptance of Vaishnava Dharma, then towards
Bauli, last Bauli.
Oh, your framing of this, when you were talking about religion as a larger category, and then you are referring to Brahmo Dharma, and with Rabindranath as a believer in Brahmo Dharma, and then Rabindranath then shifting towards another religion which is Vaishnava Dharma.
Hindu Dharma, in between Hindu
and
Dharma.
In between there is Sanatana Hindu Dharma. And it seems to suggest, I don't know on what grounds you are making this distinction, and that is querying the entire pitch of your presentation. As if Brahmo Dharma is a separate religion, as if Sanatana Hindu is a separate religion, as if Vaishnava Dharma is a separate religion. And that these, and therefore somehow Rabindranath Tagore was dissatisfied with all these religions, ultimately finding some satisfaction in his own notion of personalized religion. I mean, this seems to be, I don't know on what ground, on what premises are you really taking all these kind of ideas, Brahmo as a separate dharma, and there is something known as Sanatana Dharma as a separate religion, and this Vaishnava is a separate religion. And we can go on then multiplying religions. We can then talk of Gandhism as a separate religion which has certain body of ideas. Then we can talk about, let's say, any number of religions. I am just feeling to understand. You saying that Rabindranath Tagore, in Vaishnavism, he found mutual love. Not only God loves him, but God loves him back. There has to be a personalized unity. So is Brahmo Dharma, deism, theism, the whole idea that there is an omnipresence, loving God, and God is in you, and you are in God. This deism, this whole idea of theism, wherein that the Brahmo, the fundamental idea of God, Brahmo was one unified, loving God. So I fail to understand on what basis you kind of create all these separate religions.
Can you tell can you tell me one thing? I just want to ask, Prabhu. Do you think that Brahmo Dharma is identical with Hindu Dharma, is identical with Vaishnava Dharma.
Why not? Why is Brahmo Dharma so different?
Why Hindu Dharma?
Let's ask a question.
If you think everything is one religion, now give me the reason for the nomenclature. Why are these names different? Why are the devotees? I belong to this sect. Like Hindu and Brahmo, they are so different. And Hindus will feel insulted if someone calls that Hindus provide a derogatory term like Brahmo. Which is, and Brahmas also, similarly, they are ritualistic, they are not up to the mark. So why are these distinctions between the followers? And why, first of all, please give me the reason why they are termed in language. Because, you know, we think through language.
You started off with the whole etymology of religion and spirituality, and there itself you put the pitch itself. Wherein religion, there is no such word in Indic cultures as religion. You entered the entire thing through two, spirit and spiritos, and then religious, and then born.
That was a basic introduction,
anyway,
sir.
Please, whatever you want to say, say. That's fine.
That was a basic introduction to someone who is not well versed in this discourse. And you know that important discourse, where this privatization of religion is the more debatable issue these days, I have referred to them not as a part of my thesis. It is a general introduction kind of thing that you can get in any book on religion.
No, ma'am, I
There is nothing. One
okay,
is etymology.
That is over. So we'll go to the next question, please.
Thank you very much. This is with reference to what you discussed in relation to literature. Literature, which is also a creative movement, enables inventing God in one's own way, very singularly. And this possibility through writing brings the question of democracy in the context of religion, also in the context of literature. Hence, because this is also a space of freedom of expression, right, and freedom of choice. In such a context, this idea itself seems to challenge the very common idea we consider as religion, also as democracy, because this is not many against, this is not one against many. This also can be many against one, because this is very singular approach to religion. Also, very singular approach to God. Also, very singular, irreducible movement of inventing one's own self in relation to the others. So, I would like to hear from you about this.
You have explained it, the point in literature and democracy. I liked it very much, and you got the point. Yes, it is. It is personal, and it is many against one. Yes, you are right. And you know, it's a new way of seeing, and people, he has thought it in this manner, long back. Now people are thinking in this way. And at the same time, I must say that Tagore is yet unexplored. Like, what exactly you wanted to mean by this? There are much scope for working on this notion. So I just wanted to highlight how the notion of spirituality, the parameters of spirituality that fits in with the thoughts of Tagore, and later in the next lecture we'll see that it will fit with the thoughts of Wittgenstein also.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for your
Thank you.
It's not my question, actually, it's a queries, because whenever I have gone through the inter creation of the Tagore, I'm really thrilled. And at an initial stage, whenever he was in Brahmo, with the Brahmo Samaj, so he found his assertion with the entire universe. He wrote the Tumaro Ashime Prano Mono Jai. And whenever he had gone through the series of death, I mean with the Kadambari Devi, then the Devendranath Tagore, his wife, and especially the Shomindranath, he compared the existence of God with the depth of the death. And when he wrote also the Chandalika, then he find his spiritual assertion with the humanism, among the humanism. So ma'am, just I want to know that how could you relate this transition of the Tagore's spirituality in your discussion?
The question is not clear to me. Like, could you reformulate it?
Just I wanted to know that
one thing I should make it clear so that it will be like he refused to be called a Brahmo. He said, I showed him, give you the quotations, that when he said he's not a Brahmo, that doesn't mean he excluded everything from the philosophy of Brahmo. You know what he did? He took whatever he liked, even from the Baul philosophy, even from the Vaishnava philosophy. He took something, but he took the entire thing. But what he did the entire thing, he Tagoreized in his own way. So later, what we are receiving is the original contribution on something. It's not that when he is refuting Brahmadharma, then he's not taking anything from Upanishads, he's not taking anything from Sanatana Hindu Dharma. He's taking whatever he thinks is suitable. And he's not taking the entire thing. And whatever he's taking, he's not that copying and pasting. It's getting moistened by his own thinking. And it becomes a Tagoreization of Vaishnava Dharma, Hindu Dharma, Brahmo Dharma, Islam Dharma, Baul, and Christianity. Everything, whatever he finds in them, whatever appeals to you. So in that way, he's not negating, no, it's not that. He's taking something, but that is also like copying and pasting. Okay? Now tell me, with this clarity, like I wanted to clarify, now tell me what your question is.
Yeah, so that's the aspect. I mean, whenever he was believer of the Akhanda, I mean the entire universe.
He believed in the philosophy of Harmony till the end. Akhanda, so he had this belief.
And then whenever he found death, found his the God with the death of the death, like the model of Tumo Shamushuma. And then, whenever he wrote the Chandalika, then he found his entire thing under the humanism, that like the Jai Manubo, Ami Shai Manubo. So that's why I'm asking that, ma'am, this is also the philosophical transition.
These are not contradictory ideas. These are not contradictory ideas. And as because he has this philosophy of harmony within himself, and as he believes that he has within himself a bigger self, which he gets a glimpse of, which he is in touch with whenever he creates, he could bear the sufferings he had to undergo. Is not bigger, like not an ordinary person can go through so much struggle and suffering. I think he could endure such things, he could survive in spite of these things because of this philosophy. And in his philosophy, which I haven't said, like he himself was reluctant to call himself a philosopher. He was more happy to call himself a poet. But from his writings, one can find ontology. In ontology, he distinguished between fact and truth.
And corresponding to this distinction in ontology, in epistemology, he distinguished between science and art. And corresponding to this distinction in ontology and epistemology, he made a distinction in his theory of language, that uses, there are two uses of language. When you use the language directly, straightly, like the table is brown, or when you are referring in a poetic language. And he stressed so much on metaphors, because you know, when you use metaphors, then you bend the meaning. So as you cannot really reach the God, the infinite, in your own straight terms, you bend the meanings and you grasp the ineffable, which cannot be stated through poetic language, through literature, through music. And
let's Professor Nath.
We should not have a narrow conception of Hinduism.
Did he say that he was not a Hindu ever?
Let's not go back to the
question. He never said that I was a Hindu. He referred, which has evidence, he referred to that in my in Brahma Vidyalaya, there will not be anything which contradicts with the dictates of Sanhita. A person who states this, you can imply, you can derive that he believes during that time in the dictates of Sanatana Hindu Dharma. Is that clear?
And he also argued in Gora also, no?
And it is novel Gora.
J. Krishnamurti renounced all religions.
Okay, let us not go away from that.
I think we should read a bit more about Tagore. Mm. If you read novels, if you read poems, you'll be able to grasp. He's not a person that we can read five books, three books, and we can understand him.
That's not.
Thank you, Nan, for your insight. Definitely, I have engaged myself in so many things. I have raised more questions for enlistment further. When Rabindranath Tagore was the secretary of Brahmo Samaj, old Brahmo Samaj, and he often criticized him.
When he was the secretary, at that time he did not criticize.
Okay.
At that time he was influenced.
Okay.
So that period, during that period, he used to critique Shoshodhar Tarko Churamani and Bankimchandra Chattopadhyay, who are the revivalist Hindu thinkers. At that time, they also wanted to revive Hindu tradition and get rid of this rituals and superstitions, etc. So he had to argue with them for the old Adi Brahma Samaj, and he had to argue with the new faction of Brahma Samaj that is called Navavidhan Keshav Chandra Sen. They were all in that. So he had to argue with this revivalist Hindu and with the new Brahmo Samaj. He had to treat him.
Did he ever record his comment about the theory of religion and practice of theory?
Very important. As far as my knowledge goes, I've given a very small quotation. He distinguished between a theologian and a religious person. And a theologian, he detests, because a theologian wants to argue for the existence of God. He had a kind of belief that whenever you believe in God, that was not due to some arguments. You believe in it because the way of how you were brought up in your childhood, the way you think about the world, that constitutes your belief in some superpower, be it God, be it some other thing. So no argument, like you cannot rationally argument in favor of the existence of God. But in theology you have these cosmological arguments,
teleological arguments and ontological arguments in favor of the existence of God. So he was not in favor of theology. He was here, he referred to the term religion, but not in the, he as a poet, he always emphasized on the role of emotion. He says our emotions, they are like gastric juices. What do they do, gastric juices? They, in fact, whatever we eat, they digest the thing and something goes for our blood, from excretion, etc. So they are the main thing. Emotions should have some importance. So he, in a way, he gave some lectures, philosophical lectures in USA. Those were lectures in English and published during that time. I can refer to you, you can have an idea, but he didn't say like directly, he was a poet, he was not kind of philosophizing, this is the way I have systematized things. He didn't write in that way. He writes in his own way about religion and theology. One of the books is called Shadhana.
Next question.
No, he has some other questions.
You are referring to Vaishnavism so much. Do you believe, do you refer to Bengal Vaishnavism only? When you are referring to Vaishnavism, for example, Viroha Bhakti, Bhavishara Bhakti, when you are referring to them as examples from Vaishnavism, do you mean Bengal Vaishnavism? Do you explain the philosophy of Bengal?
My knowledge is limited to Bengal Vaishnavism.
Another very small question now. Each Vaishnavism, varieties of Vaishnavism in here in India. There is a theory, Nirguna Ishwara. Ishwara, the finite. Nirguna, the infinite. And at the same time, this Nirguna Ishwara can be realized at heart. Does it differ from the concept of Vaishnavism? You are differing.
Yes. I don't know whether it is Bengal or non-Bengal or Manipur. I don't know.
For example, COVID. Madam, please. For example, COVID. COVID rejected scripture, religious scripture. Rabindranath Tagore also did not give importance to religious scriptures. Kobin said that there is no God in the temple, not in the image. It is in the heart. Rabindranath Tagore also says there is no God in the temple, not in the image, but it is in the heart. Then how he is more nearer to Chaitanya than nearer to God? This is what I could not understand from the lecture.
I didn't talk about Chaitanya, and what I said, answering her question, that he himself didn't want to portray himself to be a follower of Kabir, or follower of Vaishnavism, follower of Christianity, follower of Islam. It was an open kind of thing. He took whatever appeals to him. Maybe he might take something from Kabir. In fact, during his time, 100 poems of Kabir was archived, like, and it was published during his time. It was
translated.
Tagore was the first Indian poet.
To translate 100 poems of Kabir. Yeah. Huh. So we can imagine that he had some influence from Kabir also. He had some influence from Baul also. He had some influence from Christianity also. He had some influence from Islam also, Islamic Brotherhood. And he had some, like, he might have influences from different sorts of things, but they might be contradictory. But for him, when it comes to him, he assimilates it in his Tagoreization. So, you know, even if they are contradictory, he took from A, he took from B, he took from C. Even if A and B and C are contradictory, he doesn't make it, when it comes to him and he synthesizes them in his own way, it doesn't remain contradictory. I don't know whether I'm clarifying.
Dr. Karishma.
Thank you, madam, for your interesting presentation. I was wondering, is it possible to look at how you've labeled it from the religious to the spiritual? Is it possible to look at it from the spiritual to the religious? Because at the end, it's the people who make the religion, right?
Journey is back.
Because, I mean, we get born into religion because of the society, right? Of that religion. So, I mean, even in the case of Rabindranath Tagore, for that matter. So initially, it's the individual and the spiritual, rather than the, I'm just asking, rather than the institution, this whole facade that comes along with the priests and the rituals, etc., as such.
A very interesting question, indeed. Yes, we were individuals, and then we formed a society, and society needed institutions, hence religions, our faiths, beliefs, they become institutionalized. Now those people who believed in this institutionalization of religion, they will argue that if you talk about religion of your heart or religion, your inner religion, they will say that it's not a religion, because for them religion is equivalent to institutionalization. Now if that is, that could be a point of view, that could be a point of view, but then my reply would be that Tagore did not belong to that point of view. And another thing, yes, first there were individuals formed a society, religion was formed, but then again people were disgusted with the blood sense of religion and the negative impacts of religion in the society, and then they want to come back. Because why? Here the question of privatization of religion, why did it come about? In 2015 in US, there is statistics that people are 87% believing in privatization of religion. You can believe in something, whatever you believe it. You keep it in your home. And don't compare and contrast with what other people have in their homes. There'll be no problem. So, you know, you are right. We were alone. We had inner religion. We had our own personal religions. Then it became institutionalized. Then again, from the criticisms, from the ill things generated by religion, then again towards, we are hating towards privatization of religion, which here we had a kind of synthesizing glimpse of what could be, might be the way out.
What is happening in Sabarimala does not show that we are heading towards privatization.
Let us not go to Sabarimala, please.
I mean, in Dharmamukha,
they are... this is hard time. We will come to the second round. We are diverting here and there, so please.
It's very interesting. It's always because we product generation of ours always got into this confusion whether we're religious or spiritual or faith-based or what. So this has given a lot of clarification. And I don't know how to really formulate my question now. But just trying to know, just trying to understand Bengal a little more. And Tagore's writings are either in Bangla or in English. Largely. So the what you are come to a conclusion, the Tagorean, not religion, sect or whatever understanding of religion, how is it to the mass level, those who have not read Tagore in Bengal? How the understanding has gone deep into the root to the mass level, or it's not gone. If it's not gone, then how have you really, you know, saying that how Tagore is very relevant in the contemporary time, when we have this religious divide on and off all the time, and we are still not understanding the difference between spiritualism and religion at the very pragmatic level. So how do you address this?
Suppose the mass doesn't understand many things. So what should be the duty of the enlightened? To educate the mass, to teach the mass. You cannot be guided by what the mass says. Did you get my point? So if the mass, the people, they do not accept his thing, and if they go on killing people for the reason of whatever they are eating, do we say that all people are doing this, this is right? This should be done because this is done by the mass? Never. There should be an ideal. If the mass do not know, it's our fault. We have not educated them. Even the educated people, how many people have read Tagore?
So her question is really, has Tagore gone to the masses or not?
No.
He has gone.
See,
by his poems, Rabindranath Tagore, is a mass song.
That he has done, no. Typical this religion, this context.
Of course, philosophy is hard
to swallow for the mass.
Yeah. But
the music,
dance forms, theater, anything
is done in the mass. So how is it really? Is it really understood by the mass? His philosophy of
to some extent, yes. Yes.
I have a very elementary level question, ma'am, right from your etymology and the gradation of living things which you spoke in the beginning. This is for my own clarification. I'm asking you this as a teacher. I mean, treating you as a teacher, I'm asking a doubt, that's all. When it comes to gradation of creation, we have this traditional Western philosophy stating it starts from vegetative and then goes to animals, and then there are as much as 7 stages in the gradation of creation. Of which 5 stages are occupied by this one word spirit. Because Plato's philosophy, you have this vegetative spirit and then this vegetation, and then animals with senses, vegetation which just sucks the mineral out of the soil, which is just existing like a living thing or a non-living thing, and then comes senses, 5 senses, and then moves on to the realm of spirit. And this spirit word has got 5 gradations, as you are aware of as a teacher of philosophy. Spirit comes into existence, then it reforms or identifies itself, the second one, and then the spirit becomes good, and then it sustains the goodness, and then by sustaining the goodness, it elevates itself to the status of the blissful status of heavenly status. Now my question is, this journey from religious to the spiritual ends exactly at which stage of the spirituality? If at all we take all these 5 gradation of spirit as spirituality,
I don't think Tagore would be happy to fit himself into this gradations.
No, I'm not asking about Tagore, ma'am. I mean, this general journey from religious to spiritual.
General journey,
does it encompass everything?
Thrust is that don't believe in institutions, don't go by the rituals, don't believe blindly on the sacred texts. Treat other people as your own, and you create a beautiful world where there is no distinction between the self and the other. That is the myth.
And another small
other means not only human beings, it includes the entire universe, plant world, animal world, insect world, non-living world, everything.
Apart from this, in African tradition also we have this personal God. I mean, African, even among savage people, they have this personal god. I forgot the term which they use for that. Everybody will have an individual god. In Igbo clan, no, they call it Igbi, I don't know the exact word. But in what way this Tagore's personal god is different than the personal god which is even among found among African civilization?
Okay, I can tell you one thing, that I'll give you an answer, but to understand it properly, us listening to a single lecture will not do. You have to study. And if you study, then I think I'll be rewarded. Now, everyone has a personal god. If you take it, if you interpret it in this crude language of Tagore's philosophy, but this personal god is not 100% personal to you, because it meets with others. Like he said, nature, other people, and myself. We all are united. Because this personal god, at a certain point, it unites with all the personal gods, and with, he uses the term person with capital P. We all have personality. He didn't use this personal god all the time. Personality with capital P. So whenever I'm using my personal god for myself, for my aspirations, for my achievements, then it's not having that touch with other gods. But there is a point when your personal god becomes impersonal, when your finite god becomes infinite.
Thank you.
Did you talk anything about Buddhism?
Why?
Is it there or is it not there? Tagore.
Of course, all the religions are there. And he used to revere Buddha as a great humanist.
In Jatipuja
and also
in
Chandalika.
Chandalika is a Buddhist.
Both of Avadharu Shato, he took this and he took these narratives. He had one book of poems taken from various Buddhist tales, and he has kept it. He had written it in simple poetic terms. Even they are in school children; these are rapid readers, so they get all the gist of these stories in those poems. He was fond of Buddha. He was fond of Christ. You only have to understand that he took something from everything. And then he improvises in his own thinking, in his own reflections. In that way, it becomes different.
Any other question left, ma'am?
No.
Any other doubt? You don't want to listen to her more, we can wind up. Okay, so let me conclude by saying a few words. Friends, as you have seen, this lecture has five points which we must keep in mind, and these are central to Tagore's philosophy of religion or Tagore's philosophy of spirituality. I think the first point is very clear, which was much misunderstood, that Tagore transited from Brahmo to Sanatan to Vaishnavism and back to his own concept of religion of man. Now, this is a transition, so he is really moving from certain philosophical tenets to another philosophical tenets, and they don't appeal to him because he's a creative mind. And therefore, you cannot say that he should have been a Hindu, where he said he is not a Hindu. These are not the questions which are relevant for a discussion. The fact that he critiqued all the existing religions which are institutionalized, that itself shows that he is not happy with these religions. It doesn't mean, as he has rightly pointed out, that he has not taken the good points from all religious tenets. So you will find a glimpse of Vaishnavism in his Gita.
if you read Gitanjali thoroughly, you will find that he is a Vaishnava poet. But that doesn't mean that he is a Vaishnava follower. So he is not a follower of any religion, however great it may be. As she rightly pointed out, he was very much influenced by Buddha's humanism and universalism and compassion. But that doesn't mean that he was a Buddhist. So Buddhism is always institutionalization of a religion, and he was against that. So that point should have been properly understood, but it was raised the question whether all these denominations are one or many. Certainly they are many, they are not one. Now the essence of his concept of religion is centered around the concept of Jivan Devata, the Lord of Life, that is centered in man, and that is also the surplus in man, and that is the concept of spirituality. There is something extraordinary in man which is not to be accounted for through an ordinary concept of man, that he is a mind-body or physical, psychophysical system. Man is more than a psychophysical system. In order to say this, he introduced this new term, surplus. Surplus is mostly an economic term, but actually he made it a spiritual term, a philosophical term. And the fact that he was referring to the connection with the universe, that we must really understand. What is to be united with the universe, to be one with the universe? This is exactly what Advaita Vedanta has really proclaimed, that one has to be one with the Brahman, or Brahman, or one with the universe. So this is central to his philosophy, that we must be one with everybody, everything, that is the whole universe. So that is a very central concept, which Prof. Sarkar has also highlighted very much. The last mysticism, there is a mystic experience that he is emphasizing. As a poet, nothing could have been better or more valuable for him than the poetic experience of the divinity. And that cannot be expressed in language, and therefore it is ineffable, inexpressible, on which Prof. Sarkar will also talk about when he talks about Wittgenstein, who emphasized very much on the ineffability of the experience. Experience is there, everybody has it, but it is something which we cannot really express in ordinary language. Of course, poetic metaphors will be very much relevant. So poetic language itself is another great language, another higher order language, which he will be really using. And the whole Gitanjali is partly an innovation of a new language, the language of the divine poetry. So, as to the last question which our friend raised, whether he is considered a personal god, Jivan Devata. Jivan means life, Devata means god. These are Sanskrit terms. So, whether it is same as African concept of a personal god. Why Africa? In India also, everybody has his own god. In villages, every field, every tree has a god. But that is not exactly what the poet philosopher was talking about. His personal god is also universal god, because his god is infinite, remember. Though it is expressed in a finite form of me, the choto ami, but it is a universal ami. And that ami is the Jivan Devata. That universal self is the Jivan Devata. So, with these words, I have to conclude by saying that the lecture cannot be really summarized in the way I have done it, but she has excellently put forward her views on Tagore, and as she has always appealed that one lecture is not enough, we have to go back to Tagore himself to see whether what she has said is right or wrong. So the spirit of the lecture was to convince everybody that Tagore has a great notion of religion, which is really spirituality according to her. Because by religion we mean institutional religion. So spirituality is the core of the message of our lecture today. So we are really thankful to Professor Sarkar for delivering us an excellent lecture on Tagore. After a long time we are listening to Tagore or hearing about Tagore. And of course Tagore is not somebody whom you have to be introduced through a special effort. Tagore belongs to us in the sense that he's part of our thinking, the Indian thinking. Without Tagore, where is contemporary India? So it is rightly she has really taken us to Tagore in the first lecture. Other subsequent lectures will also bring something new. So I thank on my behalf and on behalf of everybody here to her for her excellent lecture. We hope to listen to you more, madam, in the days to come. Thank you very much. IIT is waiting for us. We'll meet there again. Okay, if you have any personal queries, you can talk to her. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Sir, ek aur suchna hai.
Yeah,
Premchand ji ne request kiya aap abhi se jo library ki workshop chal rahi hai, to kal, halanki kal wo thi cultural evening, to usko unhone extend kiya hai. तो आप लोग सभी इसमें जा सकते हैं.
कल्चरल फंक्शन
यस
6 बजे
इन पूल थी
आज भी होते हैं
जी. सर आज आपको
मेरा हिंदी कैसा है बोलो
सर. सर टुडे कल्चरल इवनिंग बेस्ड ऑन रीजनल सॉन्ग्स एंड डांस सो बिहू
¿Qué es eso de?